Oh my gosh, I'm being taped. Well, so I'm making bread, and this is an antique six-burner wood cook stove that was made up in Troy, New York. It's a Fuller and Warren company. It's called a Capital Stewart stove, and it has a grate that you can burn
coal
or wood. We burn wood, and Leon can talk to you about the wood. But the amount of work it takes to cut it in short lengths.
It's a small firebox, mostly designed that way for coal. So all of the wood is 12 to 14 inches, real small. And they made a lot of ornate wood and coal stoves. This one has a water jacket, which we don't use. People heated their bath water and stuff in these tanks.
Because imagine in those days there was no running hot water. So you put your water in here in the woods, because this was probably the center of the house, right? You just cooked on it and it heated your little one-room house.
Uh-huh.
And then you took the hot water out of there, put it in a basin and took a bath. Can you imagine? Difference, huh?
And it has a pretty nice oven. You have to watch it because it'll get too hot on the inside, so sometimes you have to turn what you're cooking around so that it cooks evenly. And anyway, it's an antique that still works really well.
And it heats the downstairs of the house pretty well.
Yeah, it feels great.
And it's shiny right here because of people doing this.
That's true.
That's why this edge of the stove is shiny and the rest of it isn't, is you tend to just want to be next to that warmth. So we're happy to have this thing, even though it's not a modern airtight wood stove. It's not real efficient as far as heat goes, but we don't care. It's beautiful.
Yeah, we love it. And I've moved, this came out of the basement of the Falls Village Congregational Church about, I think, 40 years ago. And was in the original cabin I lived in down the road here. Then we moved it up to the big house. And then we've been in this house 11 years, and we moved it up here.
The stove came from the congregation?
It came from the Falls Village Congregational Church. And apparently it had a broken leg that needed to be welded. They were going to throw it out, I think.
Huh.
So that's how we got it. And you know, I love it. I've cooked on it since I was 23 years old, and I'm 63 now.
So. You don't look like you're 63.
Yeah, I'm 63.
My God, you look like you're about 35 or 40.
Oh, wow. I'll put that in the video.
Yeah.
It's cute, yeah. But so right now I'm making bread, and I've been making my own bread for 40 years. And this is how I start. I start with about, I don't measure now, but it's probably about 2.5 cups of water. And I melt the butter. It's one stick of butter that I melt in the water. And in a minute, as soon as the butter is melted, I add about a cup of rolled oats. And this recipe came from originally, and this is a really famous cookbook in Falls Village that people should know about. This is Friends of the Falls Village Daycare Cookbook. And this is, gosh, how old is this now? Oh my gosh, this has to be 30 years old. I don't think you can get copies of this anymore, but...
In the library, probably.
What makes it so cool... Oh, 1989. What makes it so cool is that all local people have put their favorite recipes in here. I've had it all these years. That's a great cookbook. Let's see if this might be ready now. Now I'm just adding rolled oats. These are organic rolled oats. So we're members of the Berkshire Co-op up in Great Barrington. It's a fabulous co-op where we get almost all of our food. And I try to only buy organic. And this is organic cane sugar. Or do you want maple syrup or sugar in it, honey?
It doesn't matter.
Okay. Maybe I'll put maple syrup in. So I'm over here to get the maple syrup. This makes the best bread, I think, is maple syrup.
Is that local maple syrup?
It is. This came from the co-op. It's Blue Heron Farm Certified Organic Pure Maple Syrup.
Uh-huh.
We made our own last year out on the gas...
Barbecue.
He bought a great pan, and he boiled down the sap.
So that was really fun.
Yeah, that was fun. All right, so before I add anything cold to this, I'm just going to make sure that the oats have set for a few seconds and soften. Basically, you can make, all you need to make a yeast-risen bread is water, yeast, and flour. You know, that's the simplest bread if you want something without any flavor. Of course, I add maple syrup and salt, so it tastes a little bit better. And we eat it every morning. We have a slice of toast with almond butter and strawberries on top. Yeah, it's good. So it's great. So we just have to let that sit for just a minute. We have to wait for the oats to soften. So this is my daughter, Chrissy Hewitt. And this is, she lives in North Carolina, and she works at Wake Forest University. So I sent her down, this is Tucker, I sent him down here for 1 year to be trained by her, because he was pretty much untrained. And she trained him. The oats are soft now. All right. So this is a bowl. My son, Chet, is also a potter. And he made this bowl in high school. I have several of his pieces here. But he does it as a hobby. All right, so this is one of his bowls. So I say Chet's not here with me in person, but he's here with me in spirit with his bowl, because I miss my kids. I really do. So this is too hot, you know, to put the yeast in. If you put yeast in at this temperature, it kills the yeast. As you know, yeast is between, it's not a fungi, it's not a bacteria, it's different. It's yeast, and it grows. And that's what makes the bread rise, of course. This is not actually Red Star active yeast. I have bulk yeast in my freezer, and I just use this jar to store it in the refrigerator. You have to keep it in the refrigerator. So to make 4 or 5 loaves of bread, which is what this is going to make eventually, you use a tablespoon of yeast. And again, this recipe is in that cookbook, if anybody's interested. So right now, of course, this is too hot to put the yeast in, so I'm going to cool it down. And one of the ways you can cool it down is to put in a cup of cold maple syrup. Because I have to get it to the right temperature before I can put the yeast in. So this is going to help. Because, you know, this is cold. This is, what, from the temperature, 45 degrees in the refrigerator. And then we got to put some salt in, right? We want it to taste. So for this many loaves of bread, it's a tablespoon of salt. This is bulk salt that we get up at the co-op. So this is still a little warm. I think the temperature is supposed to be about 110 to put yeast in. If it's much hotter than that, it kills the yeast. Okay, so we have our butter. Of course, you don't have to use butter if you want it to be fat-free. We've got our oats, which are nice and soft, a tablespoon of salt, and a cup of maple syrup. If you don't want sugar, you don't have to add it, of course. So what I might do is add a little cold water here to get to the right temperature. So since Leanne's not working in the winter, we have fun with our birds out here.
Well, we have a lot of juncos and nuthatches and chickadees and the little wild finches.
Here are the finches at the bird feeder now.
Yeah.
Oh, they're going to fly away. Yeah. Oh, well.
Here's and about a dozen blue jays. And we have pine grosbeaks.
So here's a tablespoon of yeast. And you sprinkle it on top. So now you just have to wait about 8 to 10 minutes. For the yeast to rise, because if you don't have yeast, you won't have risen bread, right?
Right.
I made that mistake, let me tell you. If the water's too hot or the yeast isn't good, the yeast is too old. So if you have to make sure that, now what's going to happen is you look at, see what this looks like now, and then in about 5 to 8 minutes, this is going to bubble up, and then we'll know what risen, what it looks like. And this is an important part of bread making. I think that people say to me, oh, it's so hard to make bread. Well, to me, it's easy to make bread, but I guess you have to have the critical factors here working right, right? And one is to have the yeast to bubble up. Let's see, I can entertain you showing you this over here. So this is a quilt of Chrissy's ribbons. And her first one
oh my God.
Was from Mount, this was, oh, Mount Bushnell Horse Farm. So that was the first ribbon she ever won. I think she was 4 or 5. And these are all the different, some of her ribbons, not all of them. When she was 21, I sewed this into a quilt for her and gave it to her for her birthday.
Wow.
Yeah, really fun. Yeah, we've had a lot of fun doing that. Yeah. We've really enjoyed horseback riding. I took her pretty much every weekend. We went to all the local shows. I took her up to the Big E. And then, of course, when she went to Mount Holyoke College, she was accepted up there early decision. She wouldn't go any place that didn't have horses, you know. So we went there, and of course, Mount Holyoke is known for its the best riding program in the United States. So she was accepted there early decision. She did very well. She ended up being the captain of the team. And these are the ribbons that she won in college. So we had a lot of fun every weekend going to shows. You know, I didn't have much money, so I had an old Suburban and an old trailer, and we were always the oldest rig in the lot, but it didn't matter. You know, she always won the ribbons. It was fun. So these are my children when they're, Chet was born in 1980, Chrissy 1984. This is a sweater I made for Chet, and this is a dress I made for Chrissy. I love my children. They were fun to raise. So this is an antique harness. I'm not sure it's an antique, but this is a harness a floor loom, and it's basically what people refer to as a rug loom. And what, you know, what our New England Puritan ancestors did, you know, they would take their clothes and cut them into strips, and because they didn't want to waste anything, they wove them into a rug. And depending on how you thread the heddles depends on, will determine what your pattern is in your weave. And this has been threaded 1, 2, 3, 4. So this is a basic, this is going to make a, this is a very basic weave. And what happens is when you run the heddles down here, I can show you here in a minute what this does. So the biggest job of getting anything like this to happen is to, the most work is threading, is making, this is called a warp,
This is a cotton warp, and the hardest thing is to make the warp. You have to do it on a warping board because it's, I think I've got about 10 yards of warp on here. So you have to, it's a warping board. It's, I don't have that here in this room, but I could show you that at some point. And so you make the warp, and then you get it. It takes two people pretty much to get it onto the loom. And my friend Jean Bronson is the person who pretty much taught me how to weave, and we used to get together every Tuesday night and do this. And then this loom came from a friend of mine. I bought it from her. And so you see, this is just a classic loom. When you work the petals here, it just changes, and this is called the shed. And when you change the shed, see now I've just been here, so what you do is you change it, and now you've crossed the threads, so you can put your next, I'll show you. Now, I was saying to Jean last time I saw her, we should get together again and start doing this. And then you, this is called beading. The other thing I have over here is this wheel, and this tightens it. So this is tightens the your whole project, so it makes a tighter weave. So you take this like this, and you just, it's pretty simple. You know what I loved about this is that if you lose power and you can't watch, you can't have any electronics, you can still weave, which I think is so cool. So you just... Oh, and I should tell you that these are the racks that I... this is important because if you came here at the end of March, these would be full of pots, because I have over 100 dahlias in the basement, and I start the dahlias at the end of March and plant them as at the end of May, and then I have dahlia blooms in June as opposed to the end of August. Oh wow, this is a good yeast. Have any trouble with bread rising here? Look at that. Now that's yeast risen. See, now we know the yeast is going to work. All right, so now you can put in a combination of anything that you want. So I use cornmeal, a little bit of cornmeal. Sorry, I'm not measuring. You can a little bit of cornmeal. You put in a variety of grains just to add to the nutrition, I think. And mostly I always use organic white flour. Sometimes I buy it in bulk. And this is whole wheat, a little bit of whole wheat. Whole wheat makes it very heavy, so you got to be careful of the amount of whole wheat. You can make an all whole wheat bread, but it's going to be pretty heavy. And then you just whisk it in. So now you know your yeast is working, so you can't really wreck this bread. It's going to rise. And people will say to me, I tried to make bread and it didn't work. And I'm like, gosh, I don't know. This is time-consuming, as you can see. But you know, while it's rising, you get to go around and do other things, like clean the barn. And I'm a nurse practitioner, and I drive 40 minutes to work every day. I work in Dover Plains, New York, at Hudson River Healthcare. And so when I'm home, I love to stay home. So what I'm waiting for is a dough that's elastic, and I'm going to show you what that means. You can follow the recipe, and I think the recipe will say 6 to 8 cups of flour, but I don't do that. I just guess I kind of know now how much flour goes in here. So when I'm driving to work, I either listen to my, you know, educational tapes for work, or I listen to books on tape, which I love.
Cool.
I love books on tape. You know, I've listened to, gosh, I go to, I love that Kane and Library, and I sometimes go to the library in Falls Village, but what happens is I work Monday, Tuesday, Thursday, Friday, and Wednesday I work with my friend, Marcia Kaufman, who's a garden designer.
Oh,
do you know Marcia?
I know her, yeah.
You do know her.
Met her at the flower farm.
That's right. Well, Marcia and I have known each other for a long time, and she actually came into the office, and of course she won't mind me saying this. And so, first she started out as my patient, and then we got talking about gardens, and she came up here and she saw my garden, and she said, Gloria, you have to work with me. And I said, well, I don't really need another job, but... So every Wednesday, I started working with Marcia as the gardener. And so we started out pretty busy with several gardens on Wednesday, but, you know, she's 64 this year. Yeah, she's the same age. She's 64 this year. She's starting to slow down a little bit. So we have one big garden that we do over in Salisbury. So in the summer, you know, starting with the garden season, we garden every Wednesday morning. And then as soon as the garden season is over, we become Wednesday girls. And Wednesday girls are, first we go swim at the pool in Canaan. Then we go into that cute little railroad cafe there. And then eat all the calories we just burned up. And then and then we go to the Canaan Library, because the Douglas Library is open in the morning, whereas the Falls Village Library doesn't open until 2 on Wednesdays. So we're the Wednesday girls, and we go to the library, and that's where I get all those great books on tape. And they really save me, because, you know, when you're driving the same route every day for 40 minutes, as you can understand, it's really great to have those books on tape.
May I ask, as a nurse practitioner, how many patients you see a day?
20.
20?
16 to 20. It's a lot.
That's a lot.
I'm pretty busy.
Yeah.
And I've been there 15, almost 16 years now, so just about 16 years. And before that, I was a nurse at Sharon Hospital, and I worked in the emergency room, recovery room, OB, labor and delivery. I worked in labor and delivery about 10 years. And so I know everybody. You know, I know everybody. I know all the doctors. I know all the patients. And so when I got this job as a nurse practitioner, I wanted to work locally, and I got the job originally with Dr. Dweck and Amenia at Hudson River Healthcare. At that time, it was Foothills. It wasn't Hudson River Healthcare. And then Hudson River Healthcare bought them out. We're a federally funded community health center, and there's 32 offices like ours now. And Amenia is one, Dover Plains is another. There's one in Pine Plains, Hudson, Peekskill, Walgreens, they're all over. I couldn't even name, there's 32 offices. So anyway, I started in the Amenia office, and then we kept losing doctors down in Dover. And Dover has a challenging population, and so that's where I've been. So now I'm kneading the bread. And the reason you knead the bread is to make the gluten hold it together. Because you knead the bread, the gluten, and you'll see in a minute what happens here. So it started out as a blob,
yeah.
And you're kneading it. So you roll it over and push it. And when I was 12 or 13, I was raised in Canaan with five brothers and sisters. My cousin, Danny Van Arsdale from California, came to the house with his hippie girlfriend. I'm telling you, this is the truth.
Uh-huh.
And she came in and she said, let's make bread. And that's the first time, because my mother never did this, and that's the first time I saw anybody make bread, and I was fascinated with it. It was so much fun. And I started doing this when I was 23, and I'm 63.
64. So you see how it's starting to get a little elastic?
Yeah.
So when you push it, it comes back. And in the book, it will tell you, when you read about making bread, this is what they mean when they say elastic. See how it kind of has a little bit of gift and it comes back, the shape comes back. See that? Do you see how it's doing it?
Yeah.
And this, and the yeast and the gluten is what makes it do that. And if you didn't have the yeast in here, it wouldn't do it. So that's the difference between risen bread and flat bread. So this is great for your upper body strength.
Yeah.
I also say it's really good if you're frustrated and you can just punch the dough. So if you're having a bad day, you can punch the dough. Right?
Right.
Of course, that's not politically correct. Anyway. Okay. So now, here's your bread. Now, it takes about an hour for this to rise. And so the books will tell you to clean out your bowl and oil the bowl so the bread can rise. Well, you don't have to do that. But you do have to cover it with a damp cloth. So I used table napkins or... I forget if this was an old... This was an old dish. I don't know if it's been in there. It's clean, so I... You wet it and you wring it out and you put it over.
And what does that do?
This keeps the...
moisture in?
It keeps the bread from getting hard on top, so it will rise. So then the next thing you want is a nice warm place to make it rise. This is a little too hot. And then what I would do here is, and if you put it on a surface that's too hot, like this is pretty hot, I can barely touch this, the bottom of the bread will start to cook. So you don't want that. So you put it up like this. Or, this is a pretty hot stove today. So this is pretty hot, I wouldn't put it here. Too hot here too. So this is what you do. You put it up here and you let it rise. It's just so that at the bottom of the bowl doesn't burn. See, and here's the temperature in this oven. It's pretty hot right now. It's, what is it up to? 300. No, actually the thermometer's a little off. My guess would be it's more like 400 inside there. Did you see the inside of the oven?
Yeah.
I think you saw that before.
Yeah, it's beautiful.
And do you see, in order to see how it works, is... So if you push this forward, there's a flow in here. If you push this forward, then the heat goes up the chimney. Now watch this. See, it's going up the chimney, and here's the flow. See how it closes it? And the heat then goes around this oven. Goes around the oven, circulates around the oven.
Amazing.
Pretty cool, really.
Yeah.
Very heavy. It was quite a project moving this in here. But it's here now, so.
Good.
That's great. Yeah. So now we have to wait about an hour for this to rise a little bit.
All right.
And if you wanted to go outside or not, or.
Sure.
Ponies! Hello, ponies! I don't want you to fall. Be careful.
She's going to come first because she likes to eat. Hello, Dolly. Here's the most famous one right here. The best one of the bunch.
Dolly.
She's so good. Oh, don't, gosh, you're right on the ice.
I know.
This is a classic Palomino quarter horse. She's registered. She's registrable with the Palomino Association and with the Quarter Horse Association.
Can I pet her?
Oh, sure. No, she won't do anything. Oh, here comes a bad boy. Here's a bad boy. Now this one will bite you.
Oh, I don't want to be bit.
Yeah, he won't really, as long as I feed him.
Okay.
This is her big show horse. He's actually 16'2". This is a big horse. He's retired now, and Mom takes care of him. I'll put that on the record for the... Now don't fall
I'm
on
all right.
This ice here.
I'm fine.
And they've all been rolling in the mud.
They're filthy, dirty, rolling in the mud. That's okay. They're horses. Now here's the baby coming. He's the new kid on the block, so he's more timid, and he knows that they're going to chase him. In a minute, you'll probably get to see that. Leon, you know what? If you feed him over there, we probably get him to come to the fence. Leon, let these mess in here.
Oh, what do you think? You think you never ate before? Yeah. What do you think? You guys are so spoiled.
Be careful.
Yeah.
Come on, baby. I'll keep the other ones over here. You're all right. There's the baby. He's coming sixth this year. He's very good. He goes out on the trail. He's very safe. Oh my gosh, they're eating these like crazy. He must be good. So, you know, every 8 weeks, you got to have their feet done. Blacksmith has to come. That's Tucker over there.
Hi, Tucker.
That's a story. Oh my gosh, you think they never ate. And look at, they have that whole bale barn full of hay there. Isn't that bale barn a neat invention? I love it. All right, okay, guys. Okay. Yeah, okay. What? Oh, this just tastes good. They're really liking these. You want to get more of the baby?
You don't eat those.
Okay. Oh, what? Oh my gosh, you're so cute. This one is just, I don't know, if he was human, he'd be on psych meds.
Really?
Oh, he's bad.
Oh, okay.
Chrissy can ride him. See how bad he is? He's going to bite her. Chrissy can ride him, but nobody else can. He'll crow hop and buck. She won ribbons on him. I don't know how she did. I'll tell you, I don't think, this girl, I don't know, I've never seen any more dedicated rider than Chrissy when it came to this horse. She worked so hard with him. And on January 11th, when she was 16 years old, he got caught in a gate, and stop, Leo, and got his leg torn up. Dave Sandifer wanted to put him down.
Oh.
So, of course, Chrissy's hysterical. Sure. If you get up, I can show you, but you can't really see it. You can kind of see the scar right there. So he ripped the skin all off his leg. It was hanging down around his knee.
Uh-huh.
Dave Sandifer came and said, put him down. Chrissy cried. So, of course, we shoved him on the back. We had to tranquilize him. It took six of us to add tranquilize to push him on the back of the trailer. We trailered him over to, never forget this, Millbrook, New York, to Millbrook Equine. Mitch Ferraro, the vet over there, put 200 staples and 200 stitches in his leg and underneath. You can see it in the summer when he doesn't have long hair. And he came home, and we had to stand up on cross ties for 6 weeks, couldn't lie down. And Chrissy slept out in the barn with him. She got a color TV and put it in front of him so he'd have something to look at. She dressed that wound every day. He would have died if it wasn't for her care. And she got up and won the public speaking contest at Housatonic Valley Regional High School when she was a junior, talking about this horse and she had and how she cared for him. And she got special permission to come home at noontime and check on him. And he made it. And that happened on January 11th. And that August 2nd, she took him down to the Washington Horse Show and won the Washington Hunter on him. Well, how's that for a story? Dolly, yes. What do you think? Look at this. This is a great picture. You better send me if there's any good pictures. Hi. What do you say, beautiful girl? Want to go back in now? Are you ready?
It's up to you. Okay. See how the bridge is doing.
That's because it's nice and warm in here.
Beautiful. This is head base.
All right, let's wash my hands here. All right, let's see how I'm doing with my bread here. Wow.
So perfect.
Perfect,
right?
It is perfecto. Then you do what's called punching down. And that's to get the air out. Now the purpose of the kneading at this point is to get the air out so you don't have bread that has big giant holes in it. Perfect. that.
Yeah.
All right, here we go. We just gotta keep an eye on it.
Here you go. The way it's supposed to look.
Yes, more wood. Wow, look how fast that burned down.
Yeah, very fast. Gosh.
This is what we do all winter, feed the stove.
Uh-huh.
You can see how hot, it went up like 100 degrees. That's what happens. Generally, I'm paying more to see. It came out perfect, huh?
Yes. Yeah.
They love it.
Yeah.
Wow, it smells good.
It smells good.